Welcome everyone. Welcome to our actually first ever art seminar. We are very proud that we were able to organize it and invite such amazing amazing speakers. I'm just going to do a quick introduction. Małgorzata Dawidek is the main coordinator and author of the program, so she will make an introduction to the seminar.
Artists and their Centrale Gallery. I've been asked by organizers of this event to introduce you a little bit to the main idea behind this seminar, and so I will tell a little bit more about this. But firstly, I would like to say that over 2 years, I've had a huge pleasure and privilege to co-work with Centrale Gallery, which is one of few, if not the only, independent art institution in the UK, which is focuses on cultural integration between the UK community and immigration, not from only one European country, but from the entry of Central and Eastern European region. That's why when I was asked by Centrale Gallery to prepare this seminar, the idea of this seminar, my first idea and my very natural intuition was to research the state of contemporary Central and East European art based on creativity of artists originally from this region. I've personally researched and published many academics' papers on the art history diversity of the former Soviet bloc countries, and this area is currently very deeply researched by Piotr Piotrowski's school in the Adam Mickiewicz University in Poznań. So hence, during today's seminar, we will look at this diversification in detail, and we will particularly focus on activity of women artists who originally come from the above mentioned region but currently live in the UK, except Sandra Hall, but she still will talk about Bulgarian artists. So the title of the seminar is a paraphrase of a notion proposed by Hans George Gadamer, who is a German philosopher of the continental tradition, in his 1970 essay, Art the Poet's Failing Silent. And in this essay, Gadamer, referring to the creative works of poets who were key for his own biography, and that was Ernst Meister, Gottfried Benn, Johannes Bobrowski, and of course Paul Celan, key figure of Gadamer's study. So Gadamer analyzed the condition of the literature of his time, we can say. Literature, he said, literature of our age. And what he exactly asked about, he wrote, I wish to ask our age and the literature of our age. Is there still a task for the poet in our civilization? Is there still a time and place for art in an age where social and unrest and the discomfort with our social life in an anonymous mass society is felt from all sides, and where the demand for rediscovering and re-establishing through solidarities is advanced over and over again? Is it not an escape when one claims art or poetry to still be an integral part of the human being? And also he claimed that, without a doubt, the world of the poet in such a time must be different. It will be related to the reporting, casual nature, and dispassionateness of a technical language. But is the poet work thereby truly a reporting, or it still permits the common fluid to be expressed in time? These questions asked by Gadamer almost half century ago, provided to be still very relevant and valid. And so that's why they are the starting point and the map for our seminar today and presentation and discussions. However, the seminar thematic scope will be a little bit more enlarged to cover not only topic mentioned above, but even first and foremost will be situated in the opposite extreme to the Gadamer study. During seminar presentations and discussions, issues raised by Gadamer will be broadened on the field of visual arts. Moreover, to contrary to Gadamer interpreting poetry, created solely by man, on this seminar we will be presented and analyzed practices of women artists, women performers, women art observers, women poets. Our seminar period is focused on the 20th and 21st century, and also geographically the main area of the seminar will be moved from West Europe, which was the region, the key region for Gadamer study, to the East European and Central region. Our guest speakers are from Lithuania, Russia, Poland, and Bulgaria. So the main idea behind the seminar is the gesture of the artist in such a time, is tracking activities of women artists who in their own practice keep a regular dialogue with current history and react to cultural changes. We will talk at the various methods, motives, and forms of work, and gestures of artists being active in the diverse art fields. Artists whose works are connected with the aspects of body conditions, but also architectural and environmental aspects and perception, which are connected with urgent issues related to the contemporary history. In this wide context, this seminar will provide an opportunity to consider a gesture of contemporary woman artists as a migrant woman, a nomad woman, confronted with civilization changes, crisis, exclusion, post-war and post-communism traumas. Women who express herself in both ways, very intimately, but also in a larger dialogue with great historical narratives. So this seminar will eventually become a platform for discussion on socially engaged art. I guess it's all for me for now. I just would like to mention that this program may be a little bit changed, like Alicia said before. So Carolina is not here, Paulina is not here as well. And finally, I just would like to say that I'm very happy that today gives us this great opportunity to host a fantastic artist, and I wish you a fruitful time, conversation, and meetings and working. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much for coming, and thank you so much for inviting me. It's very exciting for me to be in an art gallery because I'm a wordsmith, so I just swim in words most of the time, so it's lovely to be in a different space. I've just come back from the London Book Fair, which had a focus on Poland, so my brain is quite scrambled with all of that. And it's really, really nice to talk to you. I know some of you haven't had a cup of tea, and that probably means a revolution in Britain, but I hope you'll bear with me. So I'm going to be talking about poetry, and I'm going to read you some poems. I'm going to read you some poems of my own, and I'm going to read some poems by other people. Can you all hear without mics and that? Okay, good. If you don't, then just wait.
The mic is on in the moment.
Sorry?
The microphone is on in the moment.
If you want to use it, the microphone is
on. No, as long as you can hear me, nicer to just go au naturel. So I visited Poland at the end of last year in the winter because I was promoting this dual language book, which I'll say a bit more about later. And I talked to a young poet, and he said to me that he'd stop writing poetry. He said, there's no point writing poetry because you just get co-opted by a capitalist system, and it's all horrible, and it's all commercial, and he's not going to write anymore. Which I think is, you know, it has some validity, that point of view. And as Małgosia said at the very beginning, artists have been wrestling with these questions, with the question of what is the appropriate gesture in troubled times. This isn't the first time that we're discussing it, and sadly it probably isn't the last. And you may be aware there was a German philosopher who, at the end of the Second World War, Theodor Adorno, said it's completely barbaric to write poetry after what's happened in the Holocaust. You know, and he was sort of, really, this became a very famous quote, and he got asked about it, and he was really saying it's barbaric to still be alive, you know, there's no way you can sort of respond adequately. And that's also a valid point of view. It's not one that I personally share. And I suppose my point of view would be much more that of people like Toni Morrison, who is a Black American writer you may be familiar with. And she's famously said, and again, this wasn't recently, this was, you know, a while back, so that's the point I'm making, that these questions are coming up on a regular basis. And she said, this is the time when artists go to work. When the world is bruised and bleeding, we refuse to succumb to its violence. This is how civilization heals. And that's, I suppose, where I'm coming from is, yeah, this is absolutely the time that we should be making art. And I imagine most of you here are probably doing that too, rather than deciding on silence. So it would seem to be fairly simple, because what you've got to do is have a look at what's around you, have a look at the canon of your particular medium, whether that's poetry or visual art or music or whatever, and investigate that, and then think, well, how do I fit into that? How am I going to change that? How am I going to subvert that? Whether that's through content or style or tone, how am I going to make a difference? How am I going to do it differently? Simple, yeah? But it's not that simple, because as an artist, you're working on a lot of different levels. Just at the book fair, Olga Tokarczuk, was the author of the day. She's a very well-known and popular Polish writer who's got into all kinds of trouble for the things that she's said. She's had death threats made against her. And she was talking about what motivates her, and she was saying that the feeling of injustice motivates her, and she writes very much about women, she writes about the environment, about cruelty to animals, hunting, all kinds of topics like that. She writes in a very multicultural and multiracial way about the diversity within Polish culture and Central European culture, which isn't always apparent to people, well, either in Poland or outside Poland. People assume, oh, you know, in Poles are Catholics. Well, that's not the case. There are pagans, there are Muslims, there are Jews, there are atheists, you know, all kinds of people. And she very much teases that out in her books. And she was saying that there's the sort of polemic level where you respond directly to an event. But then there's another level below that, where as an artist you're working perhaps in a more unconscious way, and that has a sort of longer time frame than what happened in the news yesterday. And I thought that was quite interesting, because it's not saying, oh no, no, you know, I'm just a mystical poet, but she was, because she's a very political writer, but she was talking about these different levels. And if you go to any creative writing workshop, the first thing that you, well, not the first thing, but one thing that, that you'll be told about how to write is that you as the author, you need to get out of the way. You need to relinquish control over what you're doing and let the work speak through you. I don't know if this is the same discourse in the visual arts. So here you are, and you want to respond to Brexit, but you end up writing a poem about your mother. You know, so those are the kinds of things that, that I grapple with. So I've got some poems that I want to read to you. And of course, the legacy for Polish poets is that, you know, there's always been a tradition in Poland of the poet being the spokesman, and I say that advisedly, for the nation, because, you know, Poland was partitioned, it was invaded, you know, then there was communism, there was censorship, you know, so there's a kind of burden, I think, or gift, depending on how you see it, on the shoulders, particularly of Polish poets, of, you know, that we have to write sort of meaningful historical things. And of course, there was a big reaction against that. And there are a lot of poets who were saying, well, no, I don't want to represent the whole of Polish history. I want to write about my mother or about trees or whatever. And now Poland's kind of in quite a critical place again, as much of the world is. And so suddenly, at the London Book Fair, every interviewer was asking the writers, how are you going to respond to what's going on in the country? And that was the sort of hot question that everybody was asking the writers, and, you know, their responses varied. Okay, that's enough of me. I'm going to start with a poem by the American Jewish feminist lesbian writer Adrienne Rich. And again, this poem wasn't written yesterday. It was written back in the 1990s, and the poem is called What Kind of Times Are These? There's a place between two strands of trees where the grass grows uphill and the old revolutionary road breaks off into shadows near a meeting house abandoned by the persecuted who disappear into those shadows. I've walked there picking mushrooms at the edge of dread, but don't be fooled. This isn't a Russian poem. This is not somewhere else, but here. Our country moving closer to its own truth and dread, its own ways of making people disappear. I won't tell you where the place is, the dark mesh of the woods meeting the unmarked strip of light, ghost-ridden crossroads, leaf-mould paradise. I know already who wants to buy it, sell it, make it disappear. And I won't tell you where it is. So why do I tell you anything? Because you still listen. Because in times like these, to have you listen at all, it's necessary to talk about trees. If you're living, as I do, in a relatively privileged Western life, I was born in Poland, I grew up here, I don't sound Polish, you know, all of that. It is a challenge to think, well then, how do I write about people less fortunate than myself? How do I include that without it being sort of, you know, appropriating, or without it being patronising in some way? And yet I want to include as much as possible. So in a way, this is a poem about that. This is one of my own, and its title is Magadan, which, you know, to a Polish ear is a very familiar name. It's a port where, in Soviet times, prisoners were taken and then they were distributed to the labour camps around. And I think because I grew up the child of a very traumatised generation who'd lived through Nazi occupation and through Soviet occupation, war, although I haven't lived through war, war is very present kind of in my mind. And then throughout my life, there have been other wars going on now, you know, whether we're talking about former Yugoslavia or whether we're talking about what's going on in Syria. So it seems to me that that's, unfortunately, that stays relevant. And I suppose I approach what's happening now through the prism of what I heard about when I was growing up and what was in my sort of culture around me. So I write about war. This is and that kind of oppression, and this is about what was happening in Soviet times, but I think it extends to other areas and times as well. So Magadan. On days when birds fell from the sky like hailstones, frozen by the air itself, the sun was so small it was as if it didn't know how to warm the earth anymore. In all that whiteness, they set out past the fence towards the empty plain to pull beetroots from the hard ground. On cold nights, as we burrow under down, it seems an indulgence to think of them, but I see their footprints in and out of the perimeter, follow them as they're marched again to lie next to each other on wooden pallets. And what else except this thought, retrograde comet, its heat lost in all that distance, the flare of its tail still bright enough to be visible. What else can I send back to them? When we think about how to subvert the canon or how to change the canon, we can think about what people write about and how they do it and what the style or the tone is. I think women are in a very, you know, we're damned if we do, damned if we don't, because if we write about domestic things, we're dismissed and marginalised for writing about domestic things. There's a whole problem to do with that. I've chosen two poems by men because I really like these poems, and also there's a kind of authority in the voice, which I think is quite interesting to consider. It's not an overblown authority, it's just a sort of quietly confident authority, and I think this is something that you struggle with as a woman artist. But I also chose these poems because they're about war, and one is by an Israeli poet called Yehuda Amichai, and one is by a Palestinian poet called Sami Al-Qassim. And I'm going to read them side by side together because I think they're just very beautiful poems and very human. The diameter of the bomb was 30 centimetres, and the diameter of its effective range about 7 metres. And in it, 4 dead and 11 wounded. And around them, in a greater circle of pain and time, are scattered 2 hospitals and 1 cemetery. But the young woman who was buried where she came from over 100 kilometres away enlarges the circle greatly. And the lone man who weeps over her death in a far corner of a distant country. So after Brexit last year, as you probably know, even by conservative police estimates, the hate crimes against different minority communities in Britain shot up. They were aimed at the Asian community, they were aimed at the Polish community, lots of different people And one of the things that happened to the Polish community was that they got sent messages saying, Polish vermin, go home. Mm. And because I'm a poet and I'm interested in language, I kind of decided to investigate this word vermin. And that's, you know, one sort of strategy when we're dealing with an oppression is to sort of reclaim the word or play with the word or subvert the word in some way. So I had a field day researching vermin, and if you ever Google it, you get all kinds of things. You get animals that have been made extinct and, you know, all sorts of things. And I decided to write a poem about this. And so this poem is called Are We Vermin, Mama? Are we vermin, Mama? Are we earthworm turning, shiny railroad worm flashing green and red? Ludworm dying in enormous heaps, which make noses wrinkle. Inchworm measuring new land in inches and loops. Afterwards, it stands still, pretending it's a twig. Enchanting glowworm, Mama. Maybe mealworm, to be snacked on. Hard-working silkworm, or woolly bearworm. Or woolly bearworm, surviving winters, rolling into a ball if it's picked up. Mama, are we pigeon, crow, snake, rat, little mouse, flea? I don't mind being puma. Someone said they'd seen one. Or red kite. They were nearly extinct. But look at their long wings. Mama, we could be fox, wolf, something shy that burrows, or something else that digs its hooves in. But what are they who call us them when we are us? Clouds that drift, particles of dust, same as us, to be cherished or lost. No beseeching, Mama. So because this seminar was focusing on women's work, I was also thinking about the sort of expectations on women's poets, about the way that women are portrayed in art and the kind of language that's used. And a Polish poet whom I'm translating in a book of my translations, and her work will come out in English later this year, Justyna Bargielska, is someone who just kind of blasts through expectations and stereotypes and language to do with women, and she often does it with great humour. So I'm going to read you a poem of hers as an example of that. And I'm going to read the first stanza in Polish, just so you get a flavour of that. Zo w o. Orgazm musi boleć, powiedział kontroler, bo kobieta poza kryzysem to nie kobieta. To monokultura włókiennicza. A dajcie mi raz gruz zamiast orgazmu. Odpowiednia ilość gruzu zasypie każdą dziurę. The zoo in U. An orgasm has to hurt, said the controller. Because a woman without a crisis is not a woman. She's a skeined, spinning mule. Oh, just once, give me rubble instead of an orgasm. The right amount of rubble will fill any hole. I'm currently working on the life of another woman, one who doesn't think different is beautiful at all. When asked if she knows Italian, she says, not today. On a forest path, she mistakes her heart for a tart wearing Crocs. On a road with no right of way, she mistakes her heart for the heart of merciful Jesus. On the motorway, she mistakes her heart for the heart of a corpse, which nothing will dissolve. Give me some rubble for once, as much as I need, or, I don't know, should we do it together? And I love that poem, and one of the devices it uses is metaphor, which of course is a kind of weapon for any artist. So if you read, she mistakes her heart for the heart of merciful Jesus, I think that's sort of equivalent to a long essay about how women internalize images of how they're supposed to behave. So I've got just a few more poems for you to read, to listen to. I started talking about, you know, the conscious level and the unconscious level and purpose and so on, and you don't always know what you're going to come out with when you start writing something, and it's probably the same for you if you're starting a visual project, isn't it? So you might think, you know, I want to write an angry poem and something very tender or lyrical might come out, and in a way this is what happened with this poem. Which I wrote last year in response to what was happening in the world. And I think I thought it was going to be angry, but it came out much more wistful. 2016. I've heard that cypresses point folded hands towards the sky in prayer. So I thought I'd ask this tree, which stands close to the edge of the water, and is naturally tall, though still young, judging by the tuft of untidy new growth at its peak, which, being thinner, sways a little in the wind, while the rest of the tree is upright, entirely motionless, under the slow lights of a plain cell. And even though I don't believe in anything I could explain, I thought, why not ask the tree to pray for me?
I go there because the position is not mediated, and I make that work. We choose to make that work every year, or some years we don't make anything, we just put it at the festival. And I'm very privileged to have a 10-year relationship with that community and to be welcomed back every year and asked to do more. So I think I would rather see people move into that position than the position of let's go and look at the freaks in Eastern Europe. And I've seen a lot of that. And I've seen that, like I said, and I don't do coffee table art boards. I very rarely write because I'm terrified of writing. But what I'm going to do, and then we got the roof mended and we created a kazan and we got the bell. The bell was stolen by the gypsies. Would they say the gypsies?
Yeah, no.
The bell was stolen, so we also did a fundraiser with Sophia to get the bell replaced. We didn't tell them that we were doing it. So what and I'm also not being, love me. You know, I don't do blackpeoplelovers.com either. It's just making sure that people know, that they don't have to know, but that actually I'm being as authentic and as equal as I can.
And there's a question there.
Sorry, there was a question at the back.
The question. I'm really interested in the way this conversation is going. It's fantastic. And I would say, Sandra, I really love what you're saying about this notion of owning and having an emotional response. And the word European colonialism are kind of racing around in my head. And I think that we have to recognise that as artists and as people of other, where all of us are from other, wherever the other is, we have an emotional connection to what we do. And that, what am I trying to say here? That politically, I really feel your anger, and actually, I think I share it. And Start About Your Art is about that notion that actually we can comment on things, but people will always see our comment through the prism of So we interpret what your anger through our perception of you and my understanding of you, and my understanding of whether you're speaking a first, second, third, fifth language is irrelevant to me because you're making yourself beautifully understood. Okay.
Yeah. And there's this whole daft notion that you're supposed to be objective, you know, and that so therefore an English man will be more objective than a Croatian woman. I mean,
that's the same as neutrality.
Sorry?
That's the same as the idea of being neutral. That's impossible. And just to add that you mentioned Stanley, I've just been working in Stanley on some projects around, because it's a former mining town, And just to reference something you said, Sandra, it's not to judge, absorb and react, and then do I have the right to react? Which I think answers your anger a little bit, because it sounds to me like before any of these things are done, you're actually even consciously aware of who you are and what effect that's going to have on that community. And that's not like someone parachuting in, mm-hmm. taking photographs, exotifying it, putting it in a magazine.
We really interrogate about whether, because yeah. we didn't announce ourselves in that group.
It just feels totally different, and I connect to that a lot more. And I think that really, for me, feels like the justification of that, because you said Stanley's decimated. I don't see it as that, and right. I'm English, and I was born here, and I was born in a pit town. So I don't see Stanley's decimated. I see it as there's this beautiful community there, and that horrible thing that they call Asda, which is connected to the Stanley Indoor Bowl, which I'm sure you're very familiar with.
Yeah.
When you first look at it, you think, good grief, you know, it's a disgusting building. But it's getting over that, because you have to understand your own inner prejudice around what you class as beauty, and also what you've been seeing all your life, and then going in there and finding people in their 70s, 80s, 90s playing bowling, you know, bowling together. Yeah. And how they connect, and not for me to make a, well, look at these old people bowling, but more to just sit there all day and listen to them. And I think that's different, because actually when you then create something that they're engaged in and they're part of and they're collaborating in, and actually then they wrote poetry off the back of and did their own exhibition of their own poems with my photography as a background, not as a foreground, then it's different. And I don't think any of them felt that I'd come and made them look somehow.
It's hanging out in someone's space that then allows you to respond to them. For me, this discussion is ask the question of who is the consumer of that work, mm-hmm. and is it more ethical for the consumer to be to a Bulgarian audience within the festival, within the people that are being talked about, or, you know, would it be better for you to go over there and do that work and then not deliver it there, just come up with all the research and then deliver it to a lovely white British audience. You know, I think there's
well, I'm two a moment, different... It's a switching bit, but it's actually fun. I'm a moment when I was in South Africa, in Johannesburg, and I met a woman who spoke to a lady on the morning, and I was chatting to her. Her feet really hurt. And I said, I've got decent essential oils, and come the next day. And I just decided to wash her feet, I had some wipes, and I started to massage her feet. She's a black woman. And bang, this curator was going, we've done the first intervention, we could do a show about this. White woman washes black woman's feet. And I went, fuck off. I've just made friends with her. We just sang to each other in Swahili. I'm not pimping her out. And she was really, so I absolutely know that juxtaposition thing. So if I didn't communicate that properly, trust me, I interrogate.
Right.
Or I interrogate with my partner about who's this for, why are we doing it, why? Always why. And also the other people, because there was an Iranian artist working with her. She said, I've been displaced 7 times in my life, twice from Iran, 5 times in Toronto, because of regeneration. So she was interrogating us, and she didn't know us, and her work's really, her visual work's very forefrontal. And I like working with collaborators that will professionally check, you know. And I would say that we spent 2 days before we put anything out interrogating, you know, the why. So I understand that, you know, it would be very easy to have made a
bit of flash and Joe Berry, giant rock gallery, you know.
I think that that's a very important issue connected with this paragraph.
No, I'm really glad you brought it up, actually,
because when we changed the place where we live, we always left all behind ourselves some mythical space, some space which is abandoned by us. But maybe from this perspective, it's quite important to ask you, Maria, about your biographical context, because you left this space behind you, and it's also reflected in your poetry as well. So can you say something about this mythological place?
Well, when you, I've talked to other artists about it. If you move from one country to another, there is a gain, but there's also a loss. And I think most artists I know who've done that are wrestling with, am I in loss mode? or, you know, or am I in kind of celebrating the journey and the move? And I think for anyone who's an expat or an exile or an immigrant, there's really long discussions about this. Do we celebrate where we came from, or is that a kind of nostalgia? Are we mourning? Does it still exist? Because of course it changes. You go away from your country for a year and things change. You go away from your country for 20 years. It's, you know, where is the country? And
I feel that about London. I feel like I've lost London. I lived there 30 years ago. I don't go back if I can help it.
I mean, to some extent, I think that's a question whether you're a migrant or not, because, you know, childhood is another country, isn't it? And the childhood you grew up in, it's all changed, you know. The school curriculum has changed, whether Tesco's is there or not has changed. You know, the landscape's changed, all that's changed. So to some extent, that I think that's an issue for anybody, and I think if you're an immigrant, it's heightened. And then the other question that comes up is this whole thing of you have a sort of ambassadorial role, because a lot of the time when I read my work, it's to predominantly English-speaking audiences. So there's a kind of responsibility of, you know, they may know very little about Polish culture, and they're getting my take on it, which is, you know, which is my personal take on it. But I'm kind of representing Polish culture in their eyes.
What do you think about Poland at the moment?
And it's sort of, it'll, and also, and then there's the flip side, because then the Poles might be, I mean, I've had this question come up, the poem I read to you about the mother reading necrology, reading obituaries, and the whole issue of her reaction to gay things, and people have said, "Oh, but you know, you're kind of making fun of Polish people. You shouldn't do that because, you know, there's this burden that you've got to present your culture."
Yeah, otherwise you're letting the side down. Yeah.
And I know that this has happened to other writers. You know, when writers
a lot in other cultures, it happens. Yeah.
Well, when writers like, you know, Toni Morrison or Alice Walker started writing about Black America, there was like, how can you say all that about our community? The white people will, you know, will they're on us as enough as it is. Now they're going to be on us even more because you're giving them ammunition, and you can't kind of buy into that. You have to tell your truth. I think
that's brilliant. You have to tell your truth, and I think there's a million truths in the room. And I'm actually not interested in the truth. I'm interested in authenticity. And I think there's an important difference as well.
I think you think, you know, mentioning authenticity in culture, and there are a million different truths. But actually, lots of our, I think your one poem you were reading earlier was the poem, and it had a humorous element to it. Our cultures also have lots and lots of layers. Obviously, all cultures have. And people don't always get it, and we don't, it's regional sometimes, it's from village to village, from family to family, often even within families we don't agree over the humour and the texts and terms that are used, yeah. So we kind of have our own rituals, we have our own ways of doing things, even a movement or a district means something, you know, and interpret it differently by a word.
And that's, you know, that's the exciting shit, actually.
Absolutely, and it's confusing. It confuses us, you know, when you're even using the language, because you can see people reacting in a different way to what you're saying, to what you're actually meaning, you know, and then sometimes you almost have to interpret that. So I think it's the cultural, when you're outside your immediate network, you have to kind of interpret for other people, or dumb it down, or change it a little bit. So you're always explaining, you know, using, oh yeah, that's what we do. You know, or that's what Irish people do, or that's what, whatever. But actually, even the understanding of it is often about being in that minute of it.
Yep.
Somebody said to me last night, I was out, and people were having a drink in a pub. I don't have to drink, I'm an Irish person, didn't drink, and people were having a drink. And somebody said to me,
we're not very Irish. and then somebody else said to me, oh, you haven't worn any green. I said, I don't actually have any green clothing. I don't need to wear my Irishness on the outside. I know who I am. You know, you're welcome into my world if you want, but you know, I'm just fitting wherever. And then somebody else, a friend, said to me, oh, I'm speaking to my other friend here, and they said, you haven't really got an Irish accent, have you? And I said, they already haven't spoken to me for very long, because I do. But whether I have or not, you know, the interpretation of me by other people is their view of what I should be.
And I think you've clearly got grace as well, because, you know, because assumptions are the building blocks of consciousness. People make an assumption about you, then you have a conversation with them, they shift that assumption. You can't negotiate fixed belief, but you can always negotiate kind of assumptions, and they can move. And I think, you know, you clearly got the grace to go, I don't do green, I don't drink, I'm still Irish. You know, and actually we use humour a lot in order to
do that. Humour is a real subtlety.
Yeah.
It's very ironic in a lot of communities and cultures where you depend on where you're from. It's even just the sound of the word sometimes. You know, we're talking about particular words and what they mean. The sound of the word, something we say it, and how people paraphrase it back to you, which is really interesting as well. So, you know, there are thousands and thousands of realities, and our own realities are thousands and thousands and change, every minute, depending on who we're conversing with often and what we're portraying. So, you know, as artists, I suppose we do this all the time. But, you know,
what do you do? What's your practice?
Sorry?
You've got to practice.
Very mixed media. A lot of kind of response stuff now, encouraging people to have a say. But very much around co-working with people, not at all about having a prestige or, you know, displaying people. It's very much around co-working.
Any questions?
I was just going to ask when you spoke about the elderly in Bulgaria, you mentioned that they're more afraid of being forgotten than dying. How did you kind of, was that verbatim what they said?
That was verbatim from one family member. I mean, I'm not sure that that's true. I mean, I think everybody's afraid of dying. But there is, in my understanding, I mean, I had a lot of conversations about the necrologs because, like you said, they're very subconscious, they're very normal to live with. For me, they're very unusual. So I spoke to some elders and they said, I can't be forgotten. You know, the first thing that they were saying was, I can't be forgotten. You know, it's really important that, that my family's not forgotten. And then you think, well, given that they've had a layered history of what I think an oligarch, fascism, socialism, I mean, everything that you could possibly have from monarchy right the way through, Bulgaria's had it, you know, 12 times more than half of the, you know, other countries there. So I'm also going to go, is that forgotten because people's language was buried during Soviet times, or, and then asking those questions because they can laugh when I make a faux pas or something. But what I was really feeling is people were really afraid of the family and then being forgotten, and that came much more before I'm afraid of dying. You know.
Is that because they couldn't take decisions?
I don't know. I keep trying to sort of, I don't want to walk up to the village and start stroking them death, you know, sort of thing. But also, I mean, for instance, that lady that we stayed with paint for, she lost her husband, he's a lot older than her. And we were really nervous going back the year after he died. And she said, look, he lived a great life. I was with him. He didn't hang out in the hospital. She was incredibly philosophical and fast philosophical about it. I guess because she's not middle class and neurotic as well.
Yeah.
You know, she doesn't actually have the sort of time or the, you know, because she still grows all the food. She makes all the food every day. I think it's also, but she was really, she sat with us and she said, I want Rachel to come because she wanted to tell us how he died. And she actually wanted us to know. And we felt really honoured by that. So we've got a really good friend of ours who knows her well. So he was translating her, he wasn't just translating the language, if you get what I mean. And she was like, look, he had a good life, he was really ready to go. He said, I'm going to lie down, I may not get back up. Bring me some tea. And we were going expecting of, because I was trying not to well up, you know, we'd known him for 9 years, again, lots of sign language stuff. And it was at that point I thought, actually, She's not afraid of it. And I don't know, I could be interpreting, but I felt a real honour of being taken into that place, just to that story. You know. I think every culture deals with death differently.
That's really the more talking about things that we might not be. Certain cultures are more comfortable talking about things that other cultures aren't as well.
That's but I mean, within Sikh culture, you're actually learning foreign language. I mean, my friends clean their foreigner as part of their death rituals. So you know, you are in Catholics, you have a wake, and I think that's really important to be able to stare at someone and see that they're dead, to really see that they're dead. You know. Whereas in the English don't. In Mexican culture, you go over a year to celebrate. Yeah. And really remember people, you know. I mean, I think everybody has a, because it's the big unknown, you know, the next great adventure. We don't really know, understand it at all, so everybody has got a different way of owning it, haven't they? And it's healthy, I think, to look at it, you know, without kind of it becoming, you know, art thing.
Just a question for Maria. You mentioned a few words you use, like conscious, unconscious, short term, long term art. The thing that we're seeing now in people younger than me, they want to become poets, they want to be expressive, they're very reactive. Something happens, you have a wave of emotion, and they write it straight away, and that's it. Do you think that's really why? Like, because obviously, you've been doing this for quite a while.
Not always. I don't know that it's for me to say. I mean, I think. I don't think there's anything wrong with doing that, and I think it's a natural impulse, isn't it? You know, something happens, you think, write about that.
It's very punk, actually, isn't it?
And, you know, whether it's that someone's broken your heart, or whether it's something happening in politics, or I think that's fine.
I think it's the first part of the journey, isn't it?
Yeah, because you go through it, because I guess when you first started, it was more, well, not being ageist, but it was more writing, right? So you wrote poetry down. Whereas now, my name on the right is quite.
I still use a notebook because it is to do with my age, but a lot of people will go straight to computer.
Exactly, and you get this called a keyboard warrior mentality where you can write what you say without worrying about the backlash, etc.
So
I'm trying to grasp at is when you're a poet, you might start a bit naive, a bit emotional, but then you become a bit more wise and more reflective. So is that similar to what you're
I don't think I've become more wise and reflective. I'm completely disappointed. And I think, you know, I'd echo what Sandra said. I think the older you get, the more complex everything is and the less you know. And I think that's quite healthy. And I think, as you said, that's completely healthy for an artist. I think if you're going into the world thinking I know everything, then your art is going to be really boring. So I think the not knowing is good. I think, for me, I think that first impulse, whether it's you know sorrow or anger, I think that's fabulous, and I think that energy is wonderful, and I don't think there's anything wrong with reacting. I think when people say, you know, his poem, I wrote it on the bus coming here, unless they're really lucky, that poem isn't going to be as good as if they go away and work on it and edit it. And I mean, I personally spend months and hours editing and thinking and reading other people's work. And I think, you know, the craft pays off. I hope it pays off. So I would, you know, if I'm talking to younger writers, it's not because I think I'm any wiser than them, but I would encourage everyone to work at their craft. Because, you know, because your first draft is going to have an energy in it, and it's going to have, which you mustn't lose, it's also going to have a lot of drip in it. Mm. Mm. You know, like if somebody says to you, you know, if I told you all now to write a poem about the rain, probably the first things that came to your mind, unless you're very lucky, would be fairly sort of cliched. And you need to kind of get through that crap.
To do your autobiography before you get to
get to the
story.
Sort of real nuggets. And sometimes when, you know, in the morning if I'm trying to write something and I just write absolute drivel, and I know it's drivel, but you sort of keep going. And then at the end you might get one good line. Thank you. So I would say both. Go on your nerve, you know, react, write like crazy, but also edit. because the editing is just as important as that initial, you know.
If it's post drawing edits over, that's what I'm saying.
That's what I mean. The poetry, going back a couple of decades ago, it took a while for it to be shared, whereas now I can write a poem, like you said, on the bus, share on Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, for example. Next thing you know, a year later, I've got 400 or 500 poems already all out there, and you're just not kind of feeling any of them. Then you look back and think, well, maybe if I had sat and reflected more upon the words that I was actually, the emotion I was trying to express here, and then give it time to settle and see what I'm truly trying to say.
That's to do with the noise of the world, though, and just how fast you can get. You know.
And the unconscious does some of the work for you. I mean, there is a process where if I write something and I leave it for any amount of time, sometimes when I come back to it, something has happened. Mm. I don't know quite where, but I come back to it with a slightly better or fresher angle. Mm. I mean, the good thing about being able to bang things out on the internet is it goes back to our first question. Sorry, I don't know your name.
Mia.
Yeah.
About
who gets to speak, and you know, the beauty of being able to bang something out is that you can communicate with other people. You don't have to go through an agent or a publisher or the appropriate expert to say it's okay, or you know, that's the correct view of Croatian culture, or you know, or whatever. So there is that, and I think, you know, the internet's a tool, isn't it? And it has aspects of it that are liberating, because it means we can speak to each other without that mediation, and there's a freshness there. But I think also it means that we sometimes bang out a whole load of rubbish.
I also think there's something around, you know, information is what people pay for, but it's knowledge and wisdom we need. And actually knowledge and wisdom, it's got a different percolation time, isn't it? So I think people mistake the speed of information. Because the idea of being an artist has been commodified very strongly, three types of money is monetization, commodification, commercialization. I mean, and the notion that the artist is the commodifier, in which case your interpretation was that I was pimping a career based on other people's pain or something, which I utterly refute. But I understand that position. And in a sense, that poetry thing of, well, everything comes at me fast, like I need to get it out fast, it's almost like a rhythm to be set. And it's almost like, again, well, I mean, I work around a lot of young people, although I have to say Alicia is an exception, so I work around people. That's just, and that's a compliment, and obviously to take a compliment, so I shouldn't be giving them a point. But you also see that thing when you do, you must mentor, I'm sure you're around a lot of younger artists as well, I mentor a lot. And you can see them going, okay. And, you know, there is a part of Alicia's project at the moment is to put elder and younger artists together, because that's never been in her experience of being around friction and the edge, and she's really valued that. And I'm really excited about that happening, do you know what I mean? So I think that there's been some mindsets with the internet, or the fastness, that it's so new that we're not coming back from it. But I really trust that will happen, and I think good artists rise, don't they?
What do you think the purpose or importance of work or writing that, and I mean, I totally agree with you in the sense of I don't believe anything's apolitical really, and it's quite difficult to kind of find that place, but work that pitches itself as non-political, so stuff that focuses on the humour of a story or the lightness or the nuances rather than something that's quite openly and more aggressively political. Is there still a space for work that sells itself as apolitical?
That sells itself
as apolitical?
I think there's a huge space for humour. I mean, I think we desperately need humour, particularly in these times. So I don't see a problem with that. But you see, to me, it will be political, because depending on what kind of joke you make.
Yeah.
Is
it important for the artist to acknowledge that politicisation of what they're creating. Because there are a lot of people that run around saying, oh, this, don't make political stuff, I'm just creating things that about me and my feelings. And it's like, part of me feels like there is an importance for that space to exist and be offered, but another part of me strongly disagrees with anyone trying to claim it, that it's not political, because it is.
How can you be completely removed?
It's always of the time, isn't it? I mean, you're always of the time.
And should we continue to support, should we support the idea that you can call yourself apolitical if it's bringing out these lighter stories or kind of less aggressive?
Do people really call themselves apolitical?
Oh, yeah.
Do they?
Okay.
And
the viral poetry of the internet.
Well, this was actually coming up at the London Book Fair, Market Focus Poland, because everyone was asking the Polish writers, how are you responding to what's happening in Poland? Okay, we'll come back to you in 1 second. I'll be very quick. And, you know, there was one poet who was saying, well, no, you know, I'm not interested in representing any political party, which is a very Polish thing to say because of the history, because you've been corralled and told, you know, so you absolutely don't want to toe the line.
Current things as well.
Pardon?
Current things.
And currently as well. I think you have to allow people space.
Mm.
And, you know, it also depends political who is speaking again, because, you know, if it's the state talking about political poetry, that's one thing. If it's us talking about political poetry, that's another thing. So it's a question of definition. But yes, as an artist, I absolutely want a space to just dream and think and not be following an agenda and to surprise myself.
Which is exactly why we go unfunded.
And you had this moment with one of your poems where you were saying, oh, I thought this would come out really angry, and actually it's quite, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I want that space. I'm not, you know, I don't want somebody dictating to me, you know, you should be writing this kind of poetry, because that would just kill it, wouldn't it? But at the same time, you know, if you write me a poem about a horse or a tree and you say it's not...
Photography is a kind of articulation and expression of the body through the language, through the gestures and through the writing process as well. And what do I mean by this? It's a set of our behaviors which are connected with the general culture influence on us, but also very intimate gestures which we actually develop through all our lives. To clarify this a little bit more, I would like to show you some of my works and describe them and talk a little bit more about my research. So my artistic and academic research is focused on the conflict between language and the human body, especially female body. And I'm mostly work on the phenomenon of human body as a textual form, as a text in a process, as a map, as a book, as a repository of memories and emotions. I also analyze the issue related with the elements and possibilities of language and human body as a storage for words, actually, and the process for narration. The burning question of my research is, does exist any border between I, body, and language? How does language link to our experience? How is writing and writing process connected with the body? Also, which spheres of body and its behavior can be expressed in words, and which reminds of name, and why does it happen? And also, in a little bit wider area, what is expelled from language by contemporary culture and rejected by Western cultural tradition. I ask this question because, in my opinion, what is expelled from the language is also excluded from our culture. For instance, body in crisis, this is what culture expels. I see language as a very institutionalized and very intellectual and male construct, which decides what belongs to it and therefore what becomes part of our culture. In this context, writing, especially women's writing, on the body, especially on the ill body, in the eye of culture, becomes madness. So the first method to analyze this problem isn't artistic dialogue or artistic polemic with the part of the European cultural tradition which eliminates female corporality from the writing process. In my mother tongue, the term body means ciało, has four meanings, and these are anatomical, social, physical, and astronomical meanings. In English, the word body has tens of meanings, and one of them is text. To be precise, a text except the introduction and index and conclusion. So the body of the text, the core of the text, is body of the text. Body equals text. Works presented here belongs to the series body texts, and these are self-portraits of the body covered with text. And this text is strongly connected with body conditioning, because also what I should mention is that what I'm really interested in the body is its very critical states, like pain or loss or blockages, also linguistic blockages, and difficulties with expression of emotions and body states general to the language. So in this work, I try to translate body states into the language and incarnate language, because for me that was quite important to meet this, what is not very physical in the body, which means emotions and not very material states, and what is very material in text. So it's color, forms, and even scale. Another work which I would like to show you is a large scale drawing, which calls the Wheel of Emotions, and this drawing is a 10 days long performance. This drawing actually shows deep conflict between feelings and its attempted expression in language. This is a diagram and map, the kinds of map of different names of emotions which are defined in various languages. In the center of this drawing, I put very basic emotions, because I made really thorough research on this, and what I found is that there are many theories about basic emotions. Some of them, some of the researchers established just four emotions, some of them established eight or more, up to 16, I can say. So I compared this researcher. And based on this, I established my own picture of the diagram of emotions. And I choose eight basic emotions, which are exactly in this center. And I found also around 100 words describing derivative emotions in dictionaries of European languages, I can say, because we can easily translate these names of emotions from language to language in European languages. And I put them on the perimeter of this circle, so over here. tense emotions, and this work is work in progress, so we can see even the final picture of this this study. But I found tens of terms which are usually originally come from Hebrew and Asian languages, and they are describing feelings emerging on the very border of two or three emotions. And these are situated outside of the circle. We have Chinese, Russian, but also we have very important words for Welsh culture. Above is Hebrew as well, and Japanese. There is a very interesting emotion which is defined in German language, which names Schadenfreude. It means exactly the pleasure which we feel because of someone's failure or unsuccess. And to conclude this part of my presentation, I just would like to very briefly say that, in contrary to the language in which I'm interested in, very material aspect when it comes to the body, what interested me is this immaterial aspect, very delicate and subtle gesture, very subjective gesture, but also the gesture inscribed into our body by the cultural tradition, which is like one big container of our behavior and body as a textual form. And it's also kind of bodygraphical dictionary as well. I also agree that the corporeal condition is inscribed into a very individual human body as a part of its identity. And such as poses normativeness. So our gestures are very individual. And even very common gestures, which are used by mass of people, are made in a very individual way. So furthermore, it's a subjective feeling and requires an individual set of methods to survive in the extreme situations. And so that's why the next project, which I would like to show you, is a project which is here for my research and is connected with this surviving process in very critical situations. This project calls self-soothing and it addresses a group of people who struggle with chronic pain and discomfort and fatigue, and who look for a way of communication with their close ones, with doctors, with the medical scientists around them. So in this project, I focus on the group of people who struggle especially with rare diseases. And these are known in the medical jargon as expert patients because of their very deep knowledge about their condition and also the methods how to cope with these conditions. Sometimes even they know more about their conditions than medical research. These patients know the symptoms very well, so they give some hint to medical scientists as well. I developed this project in King's College Hospital, and I co-work with Dr. Austin Kulasakarari, who is the rare diseases specialist, and he is also supervisor of this project. However, the most important group of people who I co-work with are volunteers and members of the rare diseases support group. These are people with chronic health conditions who live with pain or discomfort or fatigue, and who also struggle with depression, which is slightly linked with their conditions. So what I do is I interview these people and collect data provided by these patients. And at the same time, I make a set of photographs which contains the gestures and the methods how these people cope themselves with this pain in very critical states.
This is quite important in terms of general knowledge how these people tackle the problem which they meet during the constant actually state when they are ill and while they are in crisis. So why do you the visual representation of physical and emotional crises with a special attention to self-soothing and self-caring processes, but also maybe even more important at the very beginning, to self-analyze, because self-analytical process is the starting point for these people. They need to be very aware in which place in their organism pain or discomfort appears, and then they, in a very aware way, react on this. And also, I understand the notion of crisis in a very individual matter, because it means something different for everyone, because everyone has different pain and also different thresholds of discomfort tolerance. I suggested two options of work with patients during realizing the project. The first one is the very direct work with these patients who want to present their body directly on the photos. I want to present their gestures, body position, sometimes words, and sometimes pictures, which help them to get better while in crisis. And another method is about a reconstruction of someone's body gesture or behaviors in crisis by me or by other patients or project participants. And this happened when patients really want to be engaged in the project but don't want to present herself or himself on the photography. But also what I realized that it's very important to check by patients the body positions of other patients to actually check it and find it comfortable or not comfortable for here or here. The result of my project is a photographic series entitled Self-Soothing, which visualizes and records individual narratives as well as physical and mental experiences of the midlife crisis. And this disclosed corporeal reactions, positions, and gestures analyzed to reconstruct body behaviors as a very subjective part. And this series will be printed as a book guide, let's see, photo book guide, containing photographs for everyday patients and doctors' use. In terms of photography, I just would like to mention that especially in this project, the way of expressing the body is very readable because the body here is a communicative medium itself. And also I choose the color, I just resigned from the color and mentioned more white, black and white because of relation to the textual form. And maybe finally, because I maybe conclusion for our discussion time. And finally, I just mentioned that this project is driven by an intense personal desire to connect inexpressible body states with the social aspect, because it's quite important. Its ambition is to make an original contribution to the society through a series photographs communicating both personal and social issues. And actually this issue is incredibly important when talking about how expressing pain through art might help people to manage discomfort and crisis. Maybe I finished here.
Hello, lovely being here, talking to you. So, the title of my talk is the painting, looking at painting. So I'm a painter, and I studied in Royal College, done the Mayen Royal College 6 years ago, what it does in the world, in the contemporary world. So you cannot play this little game. You Google your favorite painting. In Google, just type your title of your favorite painting, and you will see lots of images coming up. And visually, they could be all quite different. So this is Van Gogh's sunflowers, and I mean, part of them, they not even belong to Van Gogh. And so the kind of the richness of the material and the familiarity of the image, which comes to our mind even before we enter the museum and see the painting. And also, next slide, of course, the commodity, how the paintings become the commodities. And we all know that in contemporary art market, the art fairs, paintings, it's what sells. And that's why it's the most difficult to be political in painting, because it is a commodity more than anything else. And also, it's quite a traditional old medium, which has a history. And again, it's not kind of new medium, and it's easy to make a new statement. It's quite difficult to make a new statement with something which is so old and has so much history. And I really like the question Maria asked before. It's like poetry, what does it for? What does the poetry for? And so the question is, what does the painting for? How does it act in contemporary conditions? So, and things above kind of led me gently to the question, is painting more than its own image? If we can access all the images, if we can remember them, if we can have them printed, what does actual object of canvas and paint does? How does it function as an object? And I noticed that after I've been doing a project with National Trust, and sometimes National Trust, if the painting goes to conservation, they put a print in the same place, and sometimes they don't even indicate that it's a print, and people will pass by and see it as, recognize it as a familiar image, and it doesn't really matter. So in this case, they put a photograph of the painting which went to conservation, how it looks when it's being conserved. So the image of this painting, which is familiar, indicates something else. So there is that kind of notion of aging matter. So this is the work I kind of get to get known for. And again, it takes paintings like outside of the painting convention. So there is a modernist convention of the white cube, the way paintings are exhibited in the white walls in the middle, with lots of light around. So first, at least first 4 years after all college, I'm kind of rolling that in the convention. That's another work. And again, so the kind of how looking at how paintings exist as objects in be it exhibition space, gallery storage, collector's place. So many different conditions for it to exist, and therefore we're only familiar with one, which is painting on the white wall. So this is how they exist. The slide before was how they in the studio, so it's a studio shot. This is another show in the Ludovic collection. So kind of making them slightly more performative or like dancey around takes them outside of that convention as an object. So those kind of body of work which continues with these paintings, but I just wanted to show you the kind of close-up, the image of one image. And for me, why this body of work, which is called parametric paintings, so it's the whole body of work which is called parametric paintings, and I exercise, it's not really like an image, it's more like documentation of the action. It's basically an action painting, but the action is not like drunk American abstract expressionism kind of splashing paint around. It's really precise and really quite machine-like. So in contemporary 21st century, when artificial intelligence becomes one of the threads, official threads for human condition, so how robotic can somebody be? So they all executed by hand. They're all executed by hand. This is kind of video, which I don't know. I do it, it's almost like sport or an exercise. The precision of the gestures is important, but also the fact that they're all parametric, which means that they could be digitally replicated or produced the parametric architecture. It was somebody who worked with Zaha Hadid, coined the term, so that any curve has parameters. So it's three dots, and it could be replicated, it could be scaled, so that lots of different curves kind of makes it really easily replicable. And those work, talk about the artist's labor. So this is something which is kind of overproduced. This is an offcuts and discarded work, discarded paintings. And they come up into this kind of still lives or arrangements, which came part of this parametric painting discourse. Another convention which painting carries is how we photograph paintings, or how we used to read the images of the paintings, being well photographed and well lit. So this is the slide I sent to Vienna Biennial last year, 2015. So when somebody asks you to send an image of the painting, what kind of image do they expect to see? And because the nature of the work is so subtle, and it doesn't photograph well anyway, and the light and presence is more important. So this is the image basically, and kind of breaking the convention of photography, painting is photography. Next slide, please. I don't know if you're laughing because you recognize
it. No, this is on the flip side of the other thing. It was like you've got the light and then you've got the kind of person.
Yeah. So that is the first time, I think, when kind of really consciously started to make more kind of political statements in painting, and that was part of the Abstract Possible, curated by Maria Lind, and it was a solo show in ISSE project. And I produced a series of invisible portraits. And it was 2011 was just happening. The Occupy movement were just like full blow. Like artists like Rob and Roberta Smith were writing this kind of placards with money being withdrawn from art system. So what I produce is a series of portraits with images withdrawn from the portraits. And withdrawal is from Latin, is abstract. So it's abstraction, but it's also the political gesture of leaving the frame and refusing to be present. So that sense of withdrawal, which is both formal and also a quite political statement with in line with Occupy movement, that's when the work really started to take an interesting turn. Also you notice the light, so what kind of I explained about the light before, it's how the viewer comes into the frame. So the image leaves the surface, but the viewer enters the frame, and kind of turning the tables into the audience, like why we're here, what we're doing, what we're trying to do. And that's another kind of installation. You can see very subtle paintings, completely impossible to photograph, but the viewer is very present, it's kind of lit from the bottom. And this is the work which was recently in the solo show in Nottingham Contemporary, called Public Gallery. So the notion of public art and public gallery. So painting is very, as a commodity, is a very private thing. You make something for a rich collector to put on the wall. But also, how could painting act in the public space? And clearing up, it's actually the second, or maybe the first time that the gallery in Nottingham Contemporary didn't have any expensive builds or installations. What they do, it was just bare gallery without even the lights. And they didn't put gallery lights on, and it was just the daylight and the painting again. Being so subtle and so invisible and sensitive to the light, it really benefited from the change of clouds in the sky. And the bench, you can see the bench that I felt it's very important for somebody to sit down in front of the work and slow down and kind of, there's this term accelerationism, like acceleration, economy, everything has to go fast, and people read images quite fast, but actually what happens if you slow down and just be in the public space, kind of back to Occupy movement. You can be here because we all pay for it. It's public space, it's taxpayers' money. And it's great that we can still enjoy it. So, yeah, that's just an example, really. It's like that you can probably see the painting behind you and kind of gorge the presence, absence, the visibility. Sometimes when you show the slides, it's not as obvious like what I'm talking about, why they're not photographable. So, yeah, this is just some more works from that series. Let's keep that one. So that, and the humans, yeah, the human studies series come from that show as well. So it's very subtle kind of human forms, which we can see here. And so last year, I was in this book, which is like a painting Bible. It was for me when it's the third edition. And when I studied in Royal College, that's kind of what contemporary painting does. And that's the every 5 years they publish this book of the contemporary painters. And that's what they say about digital culture, and about also kind of developing this antidote when you make your own materials. So to achieve those kind of visible effects, obviously I make my own medium, I make my own paint. Because whatever you buy from the supermarket for taste as everyone else, like, so you have to cook your own meal to make a different statement. So this is my son picking up the materials. So we started to work a lot with natural materials, and so this work is made specifically with the ash, wood ash, and earth. From the path, Kumba earth from the path. So kind of stripping the materials back to the basics and maybe a original, quite medieval approach to painting. Looking at something, what is available, what doesn't, anything which comes, not doesn't come from the packet. So something new found or and that's the same ash, kind of ash painting series. Which led me to that. Expanding my material vocabulary led me to this experiment on copper, which you can see here. And the question, maybe back on this, the question was, there was a lot of instability already in the work where, you know, the light changes, the viewer arrives, so it's not about the stable image, it's some, kind of something more. But emphasizing this instability of the painting as object led me to this kind of chemical reaction, and also studying a lot of conservation kind of issues. So painting is something which evolves, like we all, it evolves and it ages for the years. And so the kind of the body of paint is a slow reaction, a slow chemical reaction, like we all. So that this work, these three landscapes, is chemical reaction on canvas. They're not even titled as paintings. And it's industrial landscapes, which that's probably the connection you were making in the introduction.
Yes.
But they're kind of industrial, post-industrial landscapes. But also politically, it kind of talks about fracking. Like, that's quite a current issue now, what happens to the landscape if it becomes really industrialized. And why could it be industrialized if, isn't it landscape something we all own by the fact that we're on the planet, what we are here? So it's like sunshine, taking tax on sunshine. It's like, how can somebody track our landscape? And also being born in the USSR, I kind of get used to that all the land is nobody's, or everyone's. So that idea of the tracked landscape is really quite painful for me.
But it's interesting, sorry to cut in, it's just that you also own the means of your production. I mean, in terms of all of that kind of historical zeitgeist around capitalism, you're owning everything because you're making everything as well. I think there's a kind of very personal political ethic in there that's
it
really
is
powerful.
That, yeah, so that it is important that, like, the labour, artist's labour, how it's made. So it's totally into the kind of capitalist system, but still trying to be there but not to be there, or making a larger statement about the system. So if you need a guide, I think that's it. All right. That's it.
I've got questions for both of you. Małgosia, I'm curious, because you're at least bilingual, aren't you, with Polish and English, my question to you would be about what role that has played in your examination of language.
Let's go hear the heat now.
And to Irena, I wanted to ask you a bit about how the sort of, because you were talking about what role does painting play, and how does the sort of painting art canon affect you as a woman artist?
This is the issue which I try to recognize for myself for a long time, in which language is supposed to work. Because usually I work in Polish, this is my path. And to read and write very poetical and very essential texts, it's for me easier. It's not easy, but easier than to read in English. But obviously, in some point and at some moment also, the context where I live now was quite important. So I thought that maybe that might be helpful for the area where I live to provide text in language, in English, because it's more recognizable and more readable in this place. And obviously it's only one answer on this question, because another is that this, for instance, I use text of this, especially on this work, I use some of this text were written in Polish previously and translated by a poet translator into English. So this is interpretation, and this is the next level of interpretation, because the first level of interpretation is just translating body into the language. So this multi-layers of interpretation at this work is very important issue. And also illegibility of this text for people who don't speak English. For instance, when I show this work in other countries, there are a large number of people who couldn't actually fully read this text. And also watch or absorb this picture, because this text is also part of the picture. So they couldn't be fully observer or viewer of this.
Have an agenda issue with the kids. However, yes, I do recognize that probably female paint artists underrepresented in the major galleries or in museums. But it seems like in England the situation started to shift quite dramatically now with new director of Tate Gallery. And, so I think it seems to be getting to the right point with
Do you think, given the kind of vertical structure of the politic of the fine art world, which is so narrow for painters, as you pointed out, do you think that Maria coming in is something around, she's just going to maintain that status quo, or do you think there'll be a potential shift in there? But actually, you're more concerned with the holistic approach of your own work, aren't you?
It is important, like, I remember having these conversations with my students when we were, like, still doing MA, and people were saying, oh, like, artists shouldn't have children, or you'd never have children, you're so ambitious. But I think it's wrong, like, people should have fulfilling lives regardless of their careers.
Absolutely. Well, it's not a very child-friendly environment on the whole, but it is, you've also proved that that's possible.
I guess, yeah, I think it's important, and hopefully things change. And like, now I think even in residences, I go to residences and make sure and people do make this allowances, which I think a few years ago, 10 years ago, it wouldn't be so easy. Now everything is like, yes, of course, people should also do this.
Yeah, I just wanted to ask about your work here. How important are words in the actual text, or and the visual, the overall visual of words on a body? And thinking of also Victor Turner's idea of the ritual and how important rituals are, especially the ones who go through like corporeal, very strong corporeal rituals where the body remembers that ritual even more. So is this part of that kind of idea that by putting words onto the body, you get this sense of being grounded, and also the words are taking shape, or is it more just about the visuals and what kind of experiences are you trying to get out also by putting text onto the body?
Everything, I guess. Because many of these texts actually refer to the part of the body where they are written. And also the shape of how they are written is quite important, because some of them, actually for me that was quite important, that some of these texts are readable and some of them are illegible. So like they function as a palimpsest or as a, the shape which are not very connected with the regular writing. But they refer to the mechanical, for instance, part of our body or aspects of our body. The main idea was to put the text exactly on this part of your body, which to whom they are referred. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And is there a connection between the actual text and the part of the body?
It is.
As you mentioned, your text is your title. Sorry, it's been so evaporate paintings between commodity and spectacle. So I wanted to ask about all these extra elements I saw in the photographs, not just the paintings, but the little curly cues and extra framing and so on. So I wondered if this is an element that takes it away from what it posts in spectacles, because you have to be there and take the entire thing in. So sort of, do you think it loses, is it deliberate that it loses something when it's taken the photograph of and put into that, what was it, P3 book or something? Or is it just something that you accept as an artist?
Yes, I think the connection to the space, like introducing other elements and props and giving the theatrical background. But also, like, it is important for almost like kind of think about the viewers, if somebody just enters in and sees not just the image but everything around it. And so, kind of extending that framing, as you said, extending that frame for everything around it and kind of make it more exclusive. And really, the bits are quite often just bits of furniture, so it's discarded furniture elements, which makes it quite domestic or connects to the humanly populated domestic space.
It's also quite humorous. I mean, there are a couple of curls that kind of make you go, you know, and it's kind of nice interrupting that white wall space, because
it's
like white walls have got so many
stuff.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Just stuff.
I appreciate it.
I noticed you mentioned the bench you wanted in front of the painting, but I noticed in that photograph you had art on two walls,
yes,
but the bench only seemed to go parallel to one. I want to know, was that your decision, or do you meet resistance?
It doesn't have any borders, so you could see it.
So you could see it perched on the end.
And actually the installation was on the other side as well, so it's like the whole three-dimensional space and you can sit around. But the larger works, I think, specifically, they're kind of almost like in connection with, in conjunction with Rothko's larger pieces, where it's this kind of chapel experience you enter in with this kind of.
Have you been or
something? No, I haven't been, and painting it. It's kind of that kind of specifically for the larger work that really works when you sit down and you kind of come onto you.
Have you ever met resistance with you've asked for a bench and they've said no? Has it never been a problem?
No.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I mean, the Rothko, they actually have bin bags as well. Because I've been and it was stunning, and you really get to sort of, you get to just not be holding anything, you just the gaze. So you're not even kind of holding yourself, you're absolutely held, you know what I mean? And there's something about that that's really
interesting. Very interesting.
I mean, he doesn't work on this one. Are there some more thoughts or observations?
Yeah, a question for Margosh as well, sorry. About your, because your work is so much about gestures, and I see very carefully posed people in the pictures. Do you find yourself more comfortable taking still images which capture a specific gesture, specific angle, like you do in the self-soothing series? Or is it the gesture, is it video, gesture analysis that you feel you have more space to work in?
Yeah, I think that there's difference between self-soothing project and gesture analysis, because gesture analysis is a kind of process of gesture. So also because of this video is recorded in slow motion, so we can quite particularly very slowly analyze each stage. I focus on the one pose which is helpful for this person and which is key for the body itself. And because I think that especially at this project would be very hard to see, to watch, and to observe a person who struggle with pain, and in a longer time, like in a longer duration, and that would be very uncomfortable also for this person who is recording by me, because it's very intimate. So I can take a picture, like a kind of frame from this process, but I guess that I will not fair. I will not feel fair.
That's interesting. Thank you.
Also, the picture is kind of text. When I think about something essential from the video, I would rather stop this video. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
To see exactly this one point. But when I would like to observe the whole process of making something, the video is better tool for as a individual.
I've just got a topic more for Yelena. I'm just wondering, do you think that your practice changed at all after having your son? Or is it just carried on as it had done beforehand?
I think
it's
better.
Yeah.
Like, so I think the more serious work come later. So the whole work, this invisible work, yeah, I was already planning that, and then like it's the more serious work on but
he's also involved in collecting stuff, isn't he? Put it aside. Yeah.
I'm just interested because obviously with the history of women artists, and it was always a kind of you either had children or you didn't, or you had children and you sent them away, or you know, so you could carry on with your practice. And it's that kind of balancing nowadays with the feeling that children should be involved in your adult life, and how much of a distinction you kind of make with that.
Yeah.
And it's really nice seeing that image of
choices.
Yeah.
Like, what you prefer. So this helped her like really strict schedule. So I was really panicking today because I'm so used to be like 20 minutes sharp, like, and then if things go out, it sends me a bit. Because with children, you have to pick up time and everything. Like, if you're on schedule, you can be really free if everything goes out.
Speaking of which, unless there's any more questions, you need to get
to
Oh, well done. Okay, thank you. I also want to thank the audience because it's a great space, but it has been cold today. And these buildings do return the cold. I think you've been marvellous at coming back and staying. A few people sent their apologies that had to go to lunch and dinner. And I just had such an extraordinary time. I was very nervous about today. Thank you so much for inviting me. Really amazing to meet you, and thank you. You've given me some space to think about practice, which I don't get. Thank you very much. Thank you.